Hey, I'm Steve, and you're watching Car Simplified. Today, I'm taking apart some oxygen sensors, and I'll show you what's inside them. These are both used, and they're two different brands, so we can take them both apart and see if there's any differences between the two. That seems thin enough. With a lot of channels, when they take apart auto parts, there's some entertainment value to using a hacksaw or a reciprocating saw, but I like to make it easy to understand what's inside these things, so instead of having a mangled mess that you can't really make sense of, I like to cut these things open with some finesse so that there's no metal shards all over the place and you can kind of tell what the thing used to be. But they who have a big channel and I don't, so maybe that's the way to do things. I think if I get a socket for that, it might make this a little easier. Let's see if this 7/8 does it. Yep. Cool. Dust came out of there. Interesting. All right. I think we need to cut some wires. Since I was just talking about being thorough and letting you see everything, I'll pop this wire harness apart so you can see what's inside there. That's your wire plug gasket. This protects the plugs and everything in here from moisture, and it attempts to save your plugs from whenever someone's pressure washing. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. This one's pretty new. It looks like it can stand up to that kind of thing. Looks like all the brown colored wires are copper, and this purple one, which I'll show you in a minute, it leads down inside here. That one is aluminum, most likely. It's a silver color. Silver, the metal, is a very good conductor, but I doubt it's going to be used in that. This plugs into the plug here, and all this does is it separates the wires and keeps them aimed a certain direction, so that way they don't get bent really bad here. I'm sure we've all had a pair of headphones that have done that. That's just a heat shroud. Oh, mangled up one of the wires there. There we go. Let's cut the business end off of this thing. There we go. Well, that's not very interesting. No wonder they use power tools to cut these things open. There's that purple wire. This went straight to this core piece here, so that's the main wire. There we go. Oh, I mangled those wires up too. We've got this ceramic element in here that's not coming out, so I'm just gonna smash it. So it just had the four holes for wires. It was just there to insulate the front from the back end. All right, you can see three little holes in there. The only reason why you can't see the fourth one is because the ground wire is still attached, and it's attached to that metal tab in there that's near where the fourth hole would be. So the ground wire is actually just attached to this. Let's see if there's anything inside this ceramic here. There's a really thin layer of metal in there. And then it's hollow. All right, so wiring wise, we have the ground, which attaches to the shell of the sensor, the purple wire, which attaches to the metal core here, and this is the heating element. I brought so many tools into the mix today. This is the heat gun. It's gonna scan the temperature of stuff and tell you what it is. This isn't gonna be super accurate because this thing is super thin, but we got 74.4. Let's give it 9 volts of power. Normally this thing will get 12 volts. So. Oh boy, that is already toasty. Where is the temperature? Yeah, I can feel it, but it's not showing up on my temperature gun. I wonder if I can boil water with this. I was considering putting this in water and seeing if I could heat it up to a boil, but then I remembered this kind of stuff is made out of weird chemicals, metals, all kinds of stuff, and there's a chance that something in here may react really poorly with water, so safety first, maybe don't throw weird electronics in water. Whew. There we go. 91, 92, 94. 98.4 is the max it read. So this sits right down in here. Well, whenever it's not damaged, it sits in there. and it goes all the way to near the tip here, so it heats this thing up. The elements in here that sense oxygen need to be heated up quite a bit to actually read oxygen properly. So the elements in here that detect oxygen don't really do a good job until they're heated up. I believe it's at least 500 degrees. And once it's heated up, then it can detect oxygen, and that's why cars normally had to heat up before the oxygen sensors actually sent reliable data to the car. So instead of waiting for the engine to heat these things up, especially the downstream one, there's a heater element which goes inside here and heats it up faster, and 3/4 of the voltage it's supposed to have heated this thing up pretty quick. That was pretty straightforward. Now I can take what I learned from that previous experience and apply it to this. So we'll start off by cutting way down here. All right, this one actually does look different. There's a washer in here, probably just to help keep its shape. On the inside, there's just some guides for the wires. All right, and on this brand, it looks like all the wires are silver. This one's got a hefty casing to it. So on this one, instead of the ground just being the case, it probably still is, but it's also got some contacts in here that actually touch the inside material, so it's possibly a better connection. Couldn't tell you for sure. Those look like they're designed to come off, but they aren't coming off. Looks like it's smashing time. There we go. See, this wire ends up going down to the ring. Looks like this wire does as well. Oh, the heating element fell apart. Oh no, it's not the heating element. All right, so these two are actually the heating element. And these go down to the base. And you can see in there, the ceramic just presses these contacts. It's a little copper ring there. So what did we learn today? Let's start with the cable. It's got a shroud that protects it from heat. It deals with a lot of heat. The plug is on this end. It's got a predetermined layout of wires. Those wires go into the back of the sensor. Back of the sensor has a guide which leads the wires to individual points. Two of the wires go to the heating element, which is this part here. When you run 12 volts through it, it heats up quite a bit, and that heat is there to get the oxygen sensor heated up so the element on the end can operate properly. Of the other two wires, one heads down to the positive end of the sensor, and the other one heads down to either the negative end of the sensor or the ground being the entire body of the sensor. If an oxygen sensor only has two wires going to it, it is missing this heating element. Older vehicles did not have an oxygen sensor preheater like this. Really old school oxygen sensors have one wire heading to them, and then the body is grounded to the rest of the vehicle, so it completes the circuit that way. Not only did we take a look inside oxygen sensors, but we actually found out that there's different designs between brands as well. This ended up being a lot more messy than I was hoping for, but I think I did a pretty good job of taking this apart and showing you all the parts inside. If you have any questions about what you saw here, feel free to ask. If you like seeing what's inside auto parts, I've got a bunch of other videos that are showing just that. I've done one where I've taken apart an entire fuel pump module. I've done one with a PCV valve, a brake light switch. I'm always open to suggestions for future videos like this. Make sure you're subscribed so when the next one comes out, you'll be notified. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video.